So happy Friday, everybody. Welcome back. Today is January the 22nd, and this is episode number 94 of Questions and Answers for Backyard Beekeeping. So I'm glad that you're here. If you're new, welcome. If you're repeating, if you've visited before and you're still coming back, great endorsement. Thank you for being here. If you have comments that you'd like to leave for future consideration, please write down in the comment section below this video or follow the links down in the video description. If you're new, this is the way to be. So you can also look down in the video description and see what topics we're going to cover today. These are questions that were submitted by viewers over the past week, some of them as recent as this morning. That's right. That's a very fast turnaround. And yesterday I did another video about better combs. So the topic was so complicated, so involved, that I decided to just put out a standalone video that deals with that. So if you want to know about my better comb experience and what I think about it, you could look at that video also. This is also available as a podcast, so audio-only version of what you're watching right now. If you're mowing your yard or driving down the highway, whatever you want to do, it's on Podbean. And the title of the podcast is The Way to Be. If you'd like to submit your own question, but you don't want to write it down in the comment section below, please go to thewaytobe.org and click on the Way to Be page, and there's a form for you to fill out there, and then you can send me a message privately. So thanks again for being here, and we're going to jump right into it. As you can see in the opening, we're in a snowstorm. We're in an ongoing snowstorm, snowing right now. Very cold. The bees seem to be doing okay, though. So that's interesting. How do we know? Thermal images. So the very first question we have today is from Daniel in Murraysville, PA. Question, if you're okay with swarming to keep your number of beehives from expanding, but do not want to lose 75% of the population due to the after swarms, would it be advised after the main swarm happens to remove all the existing queen cells, except for two, so they can raise a new queen? Then, at a super, would that satisfy the urge to swarm again? Yes, it would. So here's the thing, when you know, and this is going to catch everybody off guard, we're talking about this a lot now because spring's going to come and everybody thinks, you know, because right now there's not a lot going on in your apiary. We're just waiting it out and hoping that everybody's good to go in there. And then when spring comes, this population explosion happens and everybody has to be ready to put their honey supers on. You have to be ready to expand those colonies because if they what stimulates the swarm? Well, spring buildup. Spring is the natural rhythm, the natural time for them to reproduce as a superorganism. A swarm is a baby bee colony. Which colony is the baby bee colony? The one left behind, not the one that departs. The one that departs is the old colony, the old bees, the old queen. So off they go. Now, we've done a lot of swarm evaluations, I personally have, for many years because I like swarms. It's the most dynamic thing to me that the honeybees do. As a major shift in what goes on in the hive. And we're going to get new genetics in there. And all this stuff is going to happen. For a new beekeeper, it can be super frustrating. One minute you're out there looking at your bees. The next minute you hear this roar in the air and you've lost the highest population of your bees with your favorite queen, possibly. Now they go to a temporary bivouac location. And a lot of things can happen. So this is if they swarm. That's why you need to have equipment ready to go. So you need at least one single deep with frames in it so that you can hive the bees when they swarm. So that means if you've got two hives, you need a third hive ready to go. Always have accommodations for that potential. The other thing is when the bees are collected, or if you find them on the branch, could you possibly return those bees to the hive that they came from? Sure could. And I've made videos about that, how to control a swarm and send them back from whence they came. These are queen cages, things to have. These are dirt cheap. You should have one like in the pocket of every bee suit you have. I don't know how many bee suits you have. This is a type of queen cage, super handy, carry in your pocket. This is a clip style. This one you can put your queen right through this opening, but this becomes a candy plug later, or I just stuff it with grass if I'm temporarily holding the queen. Plus, there's a little pop-out opening here that you can put her in there if your grass is preloaded and so on. So then you have your queen in here. Now, what happens in a swarm if they find out the queen is gone? Well, they get all active. They start searching around the surface. Her pheromone is gone, and they recognize that fairly quick. When they can't find her, they take to the air. Where do they go? Back to the hive they left. So this is why, when you discover that a colony is making preparations to swarm, you do immediate expansion of that colony. Because one of the reasons that they're swarming would be that they're too dense in the hive. The population is too high. They've run out of places to store the resources, so it's only natural they give birth to another colony. So a lot of things you can do to expand that, but we're going to talk about this particular issue here. Is it okay to let them swarm? You can, but you're going to lose that 75% unless you recombine them. So now, once you collect the swarm and hive it, is it too late to send them back? Is it? Because another option is to hive the swarm, if you know the colony that they came out of. It says here that, would it be advised after the main swarm happens to remove all existing queen cells except for two, so they can raise a new queen? Because what happens in the hive that they've departed from, there are normally multiple queen cells. By the time those queen cells are capped, they either have swarmed or they're going to swarm like right away. So once they start building out queen cells, which happen if it's a normal swarm cell, it happens around the periphery of the frame generally. And once they take off, if you're planning to go through there and squash a bunch of those queen cells, I normally tell people not to do that, and the reason is that the bees know best which one is going to be the best queen. But let's say you have to do it. You want to do it. You want to narrow it down so you don't suffer a bunch of after swarms, which can cause that colony to dwindle. Because after swarms take off with infertile queens, and little fist-sized swarms take off. And those are queens that have just hatched, and there's more queens coming, so off they go. So now, let's say you're going to pick one out. How do you pick the best queen cell to keep? This is easy for me when I'm looking at something like the observation hive, because you can see that those nurse bees inside the hive actually spend more time and give more attention to the queen cell that they want to see hatched, and they want that queen to be their queen. So you can see that some queen cells are actually, they look like a planter's peanut shell. They always droop down. And some of them are fairly smooth on the surface, while others are heavily modified. Lots of little dents, lots of little curves and surface contours and things on it. So you'll see that the bees are showing you their selection of queens by the one they give the most attention to. Also, they tend to guard that cell. There would be three or four nurse bees on that queen cell almost continuously. They also grab the queen cell and vibrate their thorax against it, and then you can see them pause and they wait, and they're feeling for a little vibration back. So they also know if it's developing, if that queen pupa is actually going to be what they want. So the bees are already demonstrating that they're showing preferences. So if you're going to get in there and do destruction, and you're going to play the master of all bees, and you're going to squish some of those cells, look for the ones that look like they're ignored, that don't have a bunch of nurse bees on them. Look for the ones that seem kind of smooth, maybe undersized, maybe not a lot of work has happened on them, not a lot of wax work. So, and then you can definitely narrow the field. I would not squash them all and pick a single one. I would leave an insurance policy, so I would want to leave at least two. Chances are the first queen that comes out of there is going to kill the second queen in her cell. Now, the other thing is, we know that they've already been stimulated to reproduce as a colony, so they've already been stimulated to create and generate a swarm, so off it goes. Let's forget that swarm. Now we know that a new queen is coming out. How long before she comes out? She's going to be out, if she's capped already, she's going to be out within like 6 days. So that's not a lot of time. I would put a medium super on that hive now. Because when she comes out, we want the entire colony, the remnants, all the nurse bees and everybody that's there, We want them to feel that they have room for expansion, so we don't want to kick out another after swarm. So we want them to know that they have enough volume. That doesn't mean add 3-4 boxes, because if one is better, more must be better. It doesn't work like that. So they already have, let's say this is happening in a single deep, and that you did that for winter, and now that they're trying to expand, that's when we want to add those medium supers. And it's also helpful if they're full of frames already drawn. Because that gives them immediate expansion without having to manufacture a bunch of new beeswax. So if you've saved back drawn comb, you're way ahead. So then you'll have your answer. In less than 2 weeks, you can do an inspection of that. And because once that queen hatches, that's a tenuous time. She's not mated. She's not fully mature. So she has to go through a maturation process. She has to physically harden up. She also gets a bunch of nourishment from the bees that are in the colony. So she's not even going to do a flight out of there until she's about 9 days old. And then after that, how long are we waiting? So that's when she does mating flights. So we want all this to happen, you know, in a perfect storm, when there would be drones and everything else in the environment for that queen to get going. So be very careful about smashing those excess queen cells, because I've seen people do that. And the one that they saved, that they chose, that they selected because they thought it would be cool, didn't hatch at all, or hatched and left all by herself for some reason, or the bees rejected her. They have to accept her too, because they have to feed her. So adding the super, narrowing it to a couple of queen cells, letting her hatch and seeing how things go from there, that could work. Next question is, somebody was telling me that they were doing, I've done everything that you said, and people in my beekeeping club say I'm crazy, and I just want to know what you think. My bees don't seem to be doing very well. So here's the thing. It's wintertime. And this is a cautionary tale about watching my videos, because I mention a lot of things. And I can understand, see, this hadn't occurred to me, because it makes sense to me when I'm presenting it to you. For example, if we mention pollen patties, then that is a method for feeding your bees in early spring before the pollen resources in the environment kick in. It's also a sugar resource. So it also has a certain amount of water and stuff. So that is an emergency resource for kicking things off in spring. But then we also talk about dry sugar in rapid round feeders and things like that. So this is an emergency feed that sits on top. So now we've talked about pollen patties or sugar on top. Or in spring, sometimes people do sugar syrup 1-to-1. And this is only for the tiny colonies. Don't feed your big, strong colonies that are doing super well. They don't need it. They're going to send out their foragers wholesale. They're going to be busy. They're going to be doing stuff. But see, and then another time I mentioned spirulina as a means of fattening up your bees just before wintertime. And then there's Ultra Bee, dry pollen sub. So what this person did was they put all these things on the hive, in the hive, at one time, including Hive Alive, which is back there. Hive Alive is something that gets added to syrup in spring to help with nosema. So when I mention these things, I'm talking to you about very specific applications. It might be emergency feed. It might be emergency pollen. There's also Ultra Bee dry pollen substitute. That doesn't mean take every single thing that I've named, put it all together, and make this massive super dose concoction that's supposed to help your bees. You have to pick one specific thing that has a specific purpose and that will help your bees along. If you pile in everything, and in the description of the message I got, it was all, a lot of stuff was all combined in a rapid round feeder. Hive Alive, Pro Health, so that's an essential oil. Honeybee Healthy. If you do all these things together, your bees aren't going to touch it, for one. It's just overwhelming. The other thing is, we only want to do this to colonies that would need it, not just as a GP. For one thing, pollen patties are super expensive. So you would do that to kick off things in spring. But if you do that, don't do a bunch of other stuff also on the same hive. The other thing is people talk about dry pollen sub. Please don't put that inside your hive. Not, this is what I personally don't recommend, but Ultra Bee dry pollen sub can be offered outside the hive in a pollen feeder. So the foragers have somewhere to go, something to get, something to bring back, because actually the greatest stimulus for your bees to start producing brood in spring would be pollen and resources that are coming in through the landing board, because that tells them that something in the environment is providing it. The other thing is we want to give the bees as many choices as possible. So if we jam everything together, this came up too with the water offerings, and we did the salt studies and observed which salts the bees preferred. So then people thought, oh, if they go to the water and they like sea salts or Himalayan sea salts, or they like, you know, Morton sea salts, whatever was in the test, then why don't I just combine all of that together and Hive Alive and Honey Bee Healthy and put that into a sugar syrup? So now I have salted sugar syrup with Honey Bee Healthy, all in the same thing. And maybe I can even add a little spirulina to that. Is that a good idea? No, it isn't. And I understand now why somebody would think that. If this is good, if all these things are good, let's go grocery shopping and jam it all into one superpower bar kind of feeding opportunity. So please don't. Please look at these things as completely separate. And when I do an evaluation and show you how I deliver it to them, like Ultra Bee Pollen, Dry Pollen Sub, I don't put that in a hive. I put that out in an open feeder. And I only did it last year to see if they would go for it. And they did. And there was a narrow time frame there, like 2 or 3 weeks before the real pollen kicked in, and then they ignored it. So it turned out I didn't need a lot of it. But don't try to make it overly convenient even for the bees. We want the foragers to find it. So when it comes down to like essential oils especially, only one. So if you use Honey Bee Healthy, choose that. If you use Pro Health, do that. Beekeeper's Choice from Blythewood Bee Company, maybe you'll use that. Or make your own essential oils, but don't create a cocktail of all of these things together is what I'm saying. It's going to hurt your bees because they're not going to touch it. So I hope that I have not muddied those waters. Next question. Anne Egan, Queensland, Australia. Well, on my foray into beekeeping, has hit another snag. I initially did a cutout, however, it was full of small hive beetles and nothing survived. I'm not sure if you remember or not. Anyway, I bought a nucleus and the man I bought it from said it was so strong, he put it in a 10-frame brood box. A nucleus is a queen, frames, fully drawn, everything going on, brood, pupa, everybody's there, resources are there. It's supposed to be the fastest buildup there is. So I drove 2.5 hours to pick it up. I also picked up a 5-frame nuke box for a friend at the same time. So we delivered the nuke and I suited up and watched, assisted him, while he installed the nuke into his existing flow hive. It was a very active, full hive. He spotted the queen. Lots of brood, lots of honey, lots of bees. So that all sounds good. I installed my hive into my backyard, 8.6 acres, and waited a week for them to settle down before inspecting. Now, this is a separate hive, so this is the one that Anne is putting in her own. So last weekend, I did an inspection, and the bad news, no eggs, no larvae, no capped brood. All empty frames with a medium amount of bees. Only about 3 or 4 squared of capped honey and 2 inches square of pollen, only thing in there. So that's not good news. Apart from the small amount of resources was 1 capped queen cell halfway up the frame. I messaged the person I bought the hive off and he said to wait 2 weeks as it could be a cycle they're going through. He opened the box when I picked it up and he showed me a new frame he'd put in 3 days earlier to show me that they are drawing new comb on a foundation frame. I'm so angry at myself for not getting him to pull out all the frames to inspect. That's an important lesson. If you're buying a nucleus colony and you're picking it up in person, definitely inspect that colony with the person that you're buying it from so you can see the conditions, you get eyes on the queen, you make sure that they've got eggs and everything else. So continue. Anyway, questions. Bees are bringing in pollen still and are active. Does this mean they know the pupating queen is alive and will soon be in their center of attention? So there's something about that too. I hope that queen cell was developed after you brought it home, because queen cells are extremely delicate. When you're shipping and moving things like a nucleus colony, that could be extremely detrimental to that frame that's got the queen cell. That queen pupating is in a delicate situation and should not be jostled or bumped or moved around. So I'm hoping there was extreme care, or that this is an emergency cell that the bees built later. Or are they just going about their business? Could the man I bought the bees off of have switched the frames into the nuke and given me the empty ones just to sell the extra nuke? It was a last minute request on my part for my friend, and he warned me that they may be angry for a while, which they weren't. Maybe that was to put me off of an inspection. Just can't understand why there would be zero brood unless something has been swapped. Also, is there such a thing as cycling? Should I do another inspection ASAP and see if the queen... So here are the problems. He suggested that she wait 2 weeks to look in on it. Well, we just mentioned that queen cell is capped. We don't have to wait 2 weeks to find out if there's a viable queen in there, and if she hatched, when should she hatch? So for the time the queen, when the egg is laid, you've got 3 days to that egg being hatched into a larva, and this is a queen. So then how many days total before she gets capped? 9th day. So then on the 9th day, she's capped. How long does it take a queen to hatch from the time the egg is laid to the time that the pupa state has finished? 14th to 15th day, right in there. So if we're already at the 9th day, within 6 days, if it's a viable queen, she's out. So you would be able to inspect to see if you have a queen that's hatched out. And then we go back to what I mentioned already earlier today. Now we've got a waiting game, which is going to be very hard because we have dwindling numbers in this nucleus colony. So it's a small cluster of bees, according to the description. There are no replacement bees coming because there's no capped brood, there's no open larvae, and there are no eggs. So we have a situation. You have a rapidly dwindling colony of bees. So if it were me personally, and if Anne has access to a mated queen somewhere, I would actually buy a mated queen and install her right away. Because before any adult bees are out that are new, let's say everything goes perfect. Let's say that queen cell is good to go and she's going to hatch out. Let's see, on her 9th day, she does a perfect mating flight. She gets out there with 15 to 20 very happy drones, and then she comes back with all those great genetics, and she's mated, and now she can start laying eggs. How far out are we? We're 30 days out before you're going to see adult bees coming out of the colony replenishing the numbers. So all of that time goes by, the numbers are dwindling, the colony is weakening. So you're really kind of in an emergency situation with that. Based on this description, too, about the bees are going out and getting pollen and bringing that in, at what rate? I always have said to people, if you see pollen stores coming in at a rate of 10 or more per minute, that's very promising. If it's sporadic and they're just, you know, randomly, oh, there's one with pollen. A little while goes by, oh, there's one with some pollen. So the other thing is the cycle question. There can be environmental cycles. Now, you pick them up from 2.5 hours away. So there, for me, a 2.5 hour drive can put me in a totally different climate. So this depends on where you are. If you're in some kind of pollen dearth or a nectar dearth, some bees do cycle back and do stop laying. But you've got a queen cell, which tells me that the queen that was there is gone, if there was one. So this is another reason why, if you're buying a nucleus colony, those are expensive. $220 is what she spent. You need to see the queen. We need to see that everything is going on. You should expect, because this is important to know, because a lot of people are going to be buying their bees this spring for the first time. bring a beekeeping friend with you if you can. And when you get that nucleus colony, number one, get it from a reputable person, somebody that a lot of people talk about. Oh yeah, I got bees from them last year. They were fantastic. They do great. So the other thing is find out, vet out the person that you're going to buy those from. And then do a good inspection of it, because you're already going to be rehiving them anyway. This is what I used to do. I don't buy nucleus colonies anymore. But back in 2006, when I got a first nucleus, the guy was very fast moving, fast talking, was not interested in shooting the breeze with me at all. And he promised me a 5-frame nucleus. He gave me 4 frames at the same price. My pleasure. And he just stacked everything in there right away. And there was no opportunity for inspection. There was no opportunity for discussion, because he had a line of people coming to get their stuff. And this was pack and ship, pack and go kind of thing. Very unsuccessful with that nucleus. So you want to, but when I bring it back, I put that directly into an 8-frame brood box. So I didn't leave it in the smaller nucleus thing. So I also tell people sometimes, bring your own hive equipment with you when you go to pick up your bees. So if you're buying a 5-frame nuke, take your hive, set it up with the person ahead of time. Tell them, I want to bring my bottom board brood entrance reducer. I'm going to put a screen on it so they can't fly out while I'm driving home. And I want to bring my own box. And so if it's 5 frames, I'm going to have 5 frames. If it's a 10-frame box, I'm going to have 5 frames already in it. And then the 10 frames will go in the center. And then while we're putting those frames in there, that's when you're going to get to see the resources. You're going to get to see the larvae. You're going to get to see the pupa, you're going to get to see the eggs if they're there, and you're going to get to see the queen, and you're going to get eyes on her when she goes in your hive. And now you at least know that the rest is your fault after you leave, that you'll know that you had everything, it's all there, it's all good to go. And that's what I recommend. I don't like the keeping them in a nuke for an extended period of time, because also when we're doing this, generally there is a nectar flow. So that's the other thing. I don't know what's going on in the environment. If you have a nectar flow and there's pollen and there's resources, because it sounds like there are, there should be no cycle. The cycle I would think of would be environmental, a dearth. That's the only thing I know of. Because the nucleus is undisturbed. They're ready to go. Usually when you set them up, scouts are flying right away, orientation flights right away. They understand that they're in a new environment and they're going to find their way around and they're going to start bringing in resources, unless you have terrible weather and things like that. So dwindling numbers, hatch and queen, they're going to have a huge struggle and they're going to have to be fed and cared for. I would personally, if I could get a hold of a mated queen from a reputable person, I would get her installed right away, because then they could deal with eggs that she's laying right away and they could start building their resources right away. And as far as replenishing their stock, their numbers. So that's the best thing I can tell you. Ulcers are such a thing as cycling. Another inspection ASAP. You want to inspect, if you put in a new queen, well, we want to inspect after a week anyway, because we want to know if that queen did or did not hatch. And if she's not out of there in 6 or 7 days, she's a dud. In fact, if she dies in the cell, you would see that cell completely chewed apart. So that's the other thing. They could chew apart the cell and remove the dead queen if she does not hatch out. So you need to look at that if it's all torn apart. They'll usually leave it intact. If a queen is hatched, you'll just see the top off and it's been torn off. And sometimes they even kind of flip it back. So you have to look carefully to see if it looks like it's flipped open and then been kind of pushed back a little bit. They won't seal it up, but it's a careful inspection that you have to do. If the cap's removed, she's out. She's gone. If it's completely torn apart and ripped into through the side, for example, and things like that, the queen actually died and the bees have removed her in pieces. So it's an unfortunate story, but I'm glad it's asked, because it may be helpful to other people who are going to buy nucleus colonies this spring. Next is from Brad Oliphant. I have a question for you about gloves. I ordered some bee gloves and they are so cumbersome. I hear beekeepers that say to use something else a lot because, for one, you can't feel anything. And two, you're more likely to kill bees. Are you using nitrile gloves here in this video? Okay, so they're showing a video, actually, an many years old video, like from 2008 or 9, and I was sticking my hands in because I was trying to find the queen in a swarm. I had three cameras on it because I wanted to get all the audio and everything and doing that. And I did. I caught the queen. I put her in a cage. I left, and the swarm went back to the hive that they... So this is a nice tie-in, too. What did I have on my hands? Yes, I had nitrile gloves. You can get nitrile... By the way, right now, it's so hard to get them because, obviously, COVID-19, all medical personnel get priority on everything. These are super cheap, kind of garbagey nitrile gloves. Blue is a color that works really good. Do not get mechanics gloves that are black. Bees pay attention to color. These are my favorites. I'm out of them. I just had these because I found them in a training kit that I take with me if I give a seminar or something. And these are my favorites because they keep, you know, you pull them off, your hands are clean, you're good to go. You feel everything through them. Rawhide gloves to avoid. Cowhide gloves. They do make your bees angsty. See how clean and new these look? These are goatskin gloves. If I need gloves to wear, I would wear the goatskin gloves. Look at the color of them. They're light. And you can smell them. If you smell cowhide, it smells strong. It smells like rawhide. It smells like an animal. It actually, other than the fact that it's hard to maintain dexterity when you're wearing them, it actually can be used as a test to see how defensive those bees are. So just cow leather passing over. This is actually pretty good. So these goatskin gloves are thin enough that you get some dexterity. Make sure the gloves fit. You ever see people put on bee gloves and there's like a half an inch of extra material on the fingers? You want gloves that fit nice and snug if you're going to wear them. If you've got really angsty bees, you're going to benefit from having this protection. Rawhide is super thick. And as I mentioned before, it's used as a test to tick off your bees. And they solicit stings. I wanted to show you. See these little mittens? These are goatskin gloves. My grandson wears them. He's 5. He's my bee helper. Tells everybody about it. But he likes to put these on. Obviously mittens, I can't even imagine. Of course, he's not inspecting hives. He's just sitting in front of landing boards. He likes to wear his bee suit and sit with his face just inches from the bees. And then when a bee lands on his little glove, and if he ever gets a sting, he runs right over to show me the stinger in his glove. What's that got to do with the story? Nothing other than nitrile gloves or bare hands are good. And there was another question, I think, in here. I was wondering about spraying my hands lightly with Honey Bee Gone. Don't do that. If you want to do bare hands, you want to put something on your hands to put them off. Some people puff smoke on their hands, but there also is something else. Get ready. Liquid smoke. I've never used it. I just heard about it. So I don't know where you get it. If somebody else knows, feel free to put a link down below. Liquid smoke, you rub it on your hands, and the bees supposedly ignore your hands. But when you put nitrile gloves on, this is not sting protection at all. But you know what it does is... it doesn't smell like animal flesh. So the bees crawl all over it, and they don't sense that this is part of the animal that's disturbing their hive. And they don't tend to sting it, even though they could very easily put their stinger through. The other thing is, so let's say that you do something knuckleheaded. Let's say you've got these on, but you know you go to grab the box. There's a bunch of bees collected under it, and you smash them all. And, of course, they sting into your hands. Well, now when you take the glove off, all the stingers go with it. So a little sting muscle that otherwise would be there and you'd have to scrape off goes with the gloves. So I really hope we can return to, you know, getting 100 count boxes of these gloves very inexpensively right now. $45-$50 for what used to be a $19 box of gloves. Pretty ridiculous, but yeah, avoid those heavy. If you're not a warrior going into Africanized bees or, you know, Asian giant hornets, Vespa mandarinia. If you're not going after something like that, you don't need thick rawhide gloves. And you're right, it's cumbersome. You're going to smash a lot of bees. What happens every time you smash a bee? As the stinger comes out, you smash that bee, they release that threat pheromone, and the venom is in the air. And of course, that's why bees all come after the same spot where that sting occurred, because they're pheromone-based. Got to get it. So avoid rawhide gloves. If you're going to wear thicker gloves, goat skin. That fits snug. Nitrile gloves are fantastic. Next is from Tony, Junction City, Kansas. Found your videos about a month ago. Have been working my way through them and learning a ton along the way. Thank you so much. One question I had was about the top entrance of your hives. I noticed you said you like to give them a top entrance for the workers to go, and that way they didn't go through the entire hive to get to where they were going. My question is, do you need to block or cover this top entrance for winter or bad weather? And if so, how do you do so? So here's the thing. Yes, I used to have upper entrances for all my hives. And there had been Canadian studies and everything else. And the thinking was, of course, if you've got a queen excluder on, the upper entrance lets the foragers come and go, of course, and then the queen is retained down below. And instead of coming through the landing board and traipsing up through the hive to get to the honey super during a nectar flow, they could fly in that upper entrance, go straight in, and of course unload their nectar to an interior bee. That is what I call a storekeeper bee. They don't park the nectar themselves directly in the cells. As the years have passed, I departed from that, so I no longer have upper entrances. I have upper vents, but I'm going to show you my configuration for wintertime, and it's kind of all year round now. I have upper vents that are screened, and I let the bees decide whether or not they want those vents to be there, and every single colony that I have has no top venting because the bees have put propolis in all the screens and sealed them completely. So their only entrance, their only vent now, is the landing board and the entrance reducer. But this is the configuration that I will go over with you. And so let's start with the top. Right now, every single of my colonies out there, other than horizontal hives, has insulated B-Max covers. I started doing that on every hive this year. The next box underneath is what I call a feeder shim. That's the thing that has the vented entrance that can also be opened completely, but I have screens going through the bottom. This is designed to house a rapid round feeder. So that plugs the hole, and then the vents were in the back, and the bees, as I mentioned, have sealed them up. So this entrance wheel here is just ornamental at this point. And some of the boxes, if you wanted to make one of these yourself, this is just a shallow super with your inner cover glued to it and then painted up for it so that it's ready to be exposed exterior-wise. My feeder shims that I build myself have integrated built-in inner covers, so then you wouldn't need it. Then we come down here, the next thing is a medium super. That's our honey resources for winter. Then we come down here to the brood box. This has honey, nectar, and it had pollen and, of course, brood going into winter. And this is what we want to see full, and we want this full of honey going in. And then the only entrance is at the bottom. And just above the entrance is a very thin, 2-inch thick, slatted rack. That provides space between the entrance and that brood board. It also prevents some drafting that goes on in the wintertime and gives the place for the bees to hang out that they otherwise wouldn't have. And then we just have the standard reversible landing board, single wooden entrance reducer for winter. That's the configuration. So, I hope that helped. So I've stopped. In other words, I no longer have a wide open upper entrance on my beehives. A couple of things happened for that. I mean, why to change? Well, for one, it's another entrance to guard. This is where yellow jacket wasps were really putting pressure on and trying to zip in there. Especially early in the morning when it's really cold and the bees haven't warmed up and they're not doing their thing yet. Yellow jackets were just, you know, wholesale, just getting in and out of that hole and just robbing the colony. And where were the honey supers? Way up high, which is what they were after anyway at the end of the year. And so the landing board, reducing to that being the only entrance, was helpful to the bees, less to defend. Also, it helped them control the climate inside the hive. If I had an upper entrance, the hot air was constantly venting out of there, and I've come to realize through the years that letting your hot air vent out through the top, even in summer where I live, unless it's over 94 degrees, the bees are still heating brood. So there were a lot of reasons that compounded as to why I didn't want to have an upper entrance. The other thing is, if you have an upper entrance and you don't use queen excluders, which I personally don't, but that's kind of an advanced thing to do. I always tell beginning beekeepers to start with queen excluders, because you may not have learned yet how to establish a honey bridge and everything else to keep them from going up, the queen from laying. But one of the problems with an upper entrance is, where do the bees put their brood? They put their brood down near the entrance because that's where the ventilation occurs the most. And they need to have a constant air exchange there, sweeping over those capped pupae, and because they need to exchange the airflow through there. Now, they normally continue to store their resources, topping it all off with honey, up in the unvented upper box of the hive. So now if we add a vent up there, we've added another ventilation source as well, other than losing heat, where if you're in a really hot area, you're not concerned at all about losing the heat. But now we've got an upper entrance. Now you might see the queen wandering up there and laying some eggs in the upper area. So now we've got brood up high, because that's where another ventilation source is. So that's also where they can maintain respiration for those pupating bees. So that's another reason. Next one, John from McLeansboro, Illinois. Heard you mention Maximilian sunflowers. I think this might be a good late season flower for my bees. Could you share your opinion on them when it comes to where and when to plant? So I'll answer that first. Maximilian sunflowers are a perennial sunflower that flowers, as mentioned here, late in the season. So they provide nectar and pollen for your bees and other pollinators. So this is another thing. I have no problem providing resources for all kinds of pollinators, as well as my honeybees. I also like to plant things that will continue to grow and reproduce on their own, perennial plants. So where can it grow? These Maximilian sunflowers tend to grow in all soil conditions. They did extremely well. Also on my property, I have wetlands. And I have a northern exposure coming out of the woods, and the soil's damp, and it's also kind of nutrient poor. It looks like peat moss almost. So just for kicks and giggles, last year I put a bunch of seeds from Maximilian sunflower seeds, and that's how I planted them, with seeds. So I just threw them out there, and then I had tilled the soil first, shallow, like 6-inch till, and then I spread the seeds out, and then I just come through with a 700-pound roller, and I drove over it and packed it all down, then I drove away. I don't water them, I don't do anything. Those were the strongest. I noticed this, that where the soil was damp, Maximilian sunflower leaves were much wider. So they were more lush in that environment than they were out in this field that I like to plant them in. So I also plant them out in a high clay content, high gravel content field that isn't that great soil rich, it's not very rich soil. So they actually do well because they have a perennial root system. They come up every year. And so they're fantastic. But all I do when I plant any of these, including my acres of sunflowers, I just till patches, spread the seed, roll it in, and drive away. That's all I do. Four-wheel drive tractor. So seeds are bare root. Seeds, where do I get them? Eden Brothers. So you can go check out Eden Brothers. In fact, if you're looking for sunflowers there, Maximilians tend to be in stock. Sunflowers, the sunflower mixes, I had a lot of people asking about where I got those. I noticed they were selling out of the collections, but I think you can buy specific varieties of sunflowers, and they're very good. Are they invasive? Now, some people do consider, that's a very good question, because it kind of grows like bamboo. It's fast growing, grows tall. That stuff can be 8 feet tall. Which for me, as a photographer and as a honeybee keeper, I love to see all, because each stalk has multiple blooms on it. And so they tower over everything, and they make a great backdrop for me. Plus, I like to see it. Now, that's an area where you need to plan for having tall sunflowers. Maximilian sunflowers are only about this big around, including the petals. And there are multiple blooms, as I said, they're long-lasting, and it's a late season. All the other flowers have gone by, There's almost nothing else. The asters are gone. Goldenrod is finished. Sunflowers are completely gone. This is a variety of sunflower that actually blooms much later and lasts longer into the fall. So, but they are considered by some people to be invasive. Do you cut them back to prevent them from getting so tall? Well, cutting them back doesn't prevent them from getting tall because they die back to the roots every year anyway. But I do get out there with a huge mowing deck and I mow everything down. And then we let them all start fresh in the spring. So really it's the root system that builds up, gets stronger, and then they grow faster the following season. And of course there's a spread. Now I notice the spread isn't super rapid, but then again, as I mentioned, the field that they're in, the soil isn't super rich. So the spread may be faster if you're in a damp ditch or something like that. And that's the next question. Would they work on a hillside or a ditch or bank where erosion might be a problem? So I guess the question here might be, could they be technically used as erosion control on a steep embankment? Yes, they could. Because they grow so well on their own, they do well even when you neglect them, and they don't require you to water and tend them like you would. Although you can, some people put them in a regular flower garden and they take great care of them. I like to have plants that can be completely ignored. And they do really well. So if you have a damp ditch or something like that in an area that like a flood area where you get heavy rains and there's a big wash and you want to use this as part of your erosion control system, they're good for that because they're sturdy. They're really tough stalks and they grow in clumps and perennial. Like I said, they'll spread out through the years and benefits the bees. So there you go. Maximilian sunflowers. I was really happy when I started. I've only been doing those for, 5 years, maybe. I can't remember. I did videos about it. And every kind of pollinator goes after them. Butterflies, native bees, bumblebees, and the honeybees, of course. So it's all great. Next question comes from Carl Robinson, Danville, California. Let's see. Better questions than before. I know you don't try to use smoke, but what is your recipe for your calming spray? And how long do you keep it? When does it go bad? Do you do a new batch every time you go out? That's a great question. And I only use this sugar syrup, by the way. See that leather pouch back there? One of my friends from high school saw that I was climbing up and was carrying that spray bottle in my pocket, and he thought I should not be carrying that in my pocket, and made that leather carrier for me. So that's what I carry, my sugar syrup, 1-to-1 sugar syrup, and I put 2 or 3 teaspoons per quart of Honeybee Healthy in that. That's a pretty strong mixture, and I use it instead of smoke. The only time I use smoke is if it's going to be too cold for the bees. So late season inspections and things like that, I'll use my smoker. But if it's a hot summer day, hot spring day, something like that, I prefer the 1-to-1 sugar syrup with 2-to-3 teaspoons per quart of Honeybee Healthy. It would also work with Pro Health. It would also work with Beekeeper's Friend. Or it would work with essential oils that you mix up on your own. But here's one thing I want to tell you about that. Once you mix that up and start doing hive inspections with it, try to stick with the same essential oil. You know, a lot of essential oils have lemongrass as their base. In fact, it's probably included in every essential oil out there. So that would become a familiar scent to the bees. So when you do an inspection, you spritz them with that, and they get that sugary reward, they remember it, and it works. So if you find a formula, pick it and kind of stay with it. Do you need 3 teaspoons? You could get away with 2. You also do this when you're inspecting or you're installing queens. So a lot of people will be doing packages this spring and they're installing queens. They want her to be accepted. There is evidence that Honeybee Healthy put in 1-to-1 sugar syrup can increase the acceptance of an introduced queen. So if you've got one of those queenless colonies that's a little bit defensive and you think they might not be interested in accepting a brand new mated queen that they're unfamiliar, ungenetically connected to, then Honeybee Healthy with sugar syrup, that would be a 3 teaspoon per quart situation. And you spritz the resident bees, you spritz the surface of those frames, the comb, and when you introduce the queen, they're much more receptive to her. And that has been tested and repeated that that helps with colonies that have otherwise rejected queens. Although last year I had a single colony that rejected every queen I tried to put in there, no matter what I did. So, not very happy with those bees. But the other thing is, do you do a new batch every time I go out? Nope. In fact, I mix up a gallon of it, and I have it on standby. And how long does it last? Well, adding essential oils to your sugar syrup extends it. I can use that same batch all summer long without mixing anything new. That's right. So it keeps it from spoiling. It's good to go. That is a very good way to preserve your sugar syrup, because sugar syrup by itself will spoil. Adding essential oil to it will extend the life of it and keep it from spoiling. So there you go. Next one is from High Mileage Mini. I wonder if that's a Mini Cooper. I saw in the past how you clean out dead bees from your flow and other Langstroth hives. Yeah, we can get them out with. And by the way, frequency of scooping them out every time you can get out in your beehive, in your bee yard. Scrape them out. Don't wait weeks. Clear them routinely to keep them out of there in winter. But how do you or your bees clean out dead bees from your long Lang hive? The entrance seems higher off the bottom. Just curious. And that's true. That's a very keen observation, by the way, because the long Langstroth hive I have out there has a 6-inch long, 1/2-inch high opening, and it is 1.5 inches off the floor, the interior floor of the hive. So the good news about that is dead bees in there don't pile up and block that, so I don't have to clean them out. And I couldn't if I wanted to, unless I had some kind of tiny vacuum that would fit in there. Because the other thing is, the orientation of that entrance, we have frame ends facing the entrance. So then there's only little openings in between each frame right there at the entrance. So the good news is, the hive entrance doesn't get blocked. I don't have to clean it. So that's actually another advantage. That long Langstroth horizontal hive is probably the most hands-off colony of bees that I have. They are doing really well. I mean, based on the thermal print, they're not even through all their honey yet. So, and the colony is a good size. And whenever we get a fairly warm day, anything over 50 with the sun hitting it, they're flying out and checking things out. So the horizontal long Langstroth hive is doing very well on its own. No maintenance. Don't have to clean anything. So now we're on to the next question. John Dickinson. Let's see. And they're 4-month-old backyard beekeepers north of Sydney, Australia. We have just completed our first split and created a nuke. 3 brood, 2 honey, 1 frame of drawn comb. So we've got a 5-frame nucleus colony going together. With a new mated queen into a new homemade long lang on the 13th of January. So we checked today on the 17th that the queen was released from her cage, all good. We have observed next to no activity on the landing board over the past 4 days, and we make the assumption that the colony is primarily nurse bees that were on the brood frames, and as such, we should not be surprised at this point. We are enjoying warm 26 to 30 degree days. So for those of you who don't know, if that's Celsius, we're talking 78 degrees Fahrenheit or more. Would really love to have that here right about now. And our other 2 hives are very active. Is this normal to see no bees? 1 bee every 10 minutes. And are assumptions valid for the new nuke like this? We have placed a pollen patty in the hive. Pollen patty in the hive. So there will be resources available for the queen to start laying, as there is no resources coming in. Is this normal for a new nuke of nurse bees? We hope to see a change in the next week as the queen and colony settle in the roles and change within the colony as existing brood emerges. We hope to gain your feedback. Well, here's my feedback. Okay, so we've already got a mated queen in there. They accept her. She's out of her thing. You should actually, after releasing the queen, this is a careful time. If we've introduced a new queen and she was in her cage and they just ate through the candy plug and she's just recently out, I like to wait 10 days minimum to check in on them again. Because they're getting acquainted with the queen, she's getting acquainted with them, and she needs to start laying her eggs, and we don't want to disrupt or disturb that. We have a lot of resources in there. You've got a 5-frame. That's great. There's already honey in there. 2 frames of honey. So everything sounds pretty good. In fact, unless you're in a nectar dearth where you live, so I don't know what's going on there. It's the other part of the world. And I don't know if you've got pollen and nectar resources. So you would glean that information from looking at the other colonies. And as you say, those colonies are very active. And if they're bringing in pollen on their own, I don't see the pollen patty as necessary at all. So I don't know that I would put that in there. If it's already in there, leave it. You know, there's nothing else to do. I would, disrupting them to remove it would be more detrimental than just leaving it there. But if there's pollen in the environment, I think you're going to find that they ignore that pollen patty. If they eat it at all, it's going to be because of the sugar content, but you've also got frames of honey in there. So that's kind of up in the air. But if you were doing it over and asking me, should we put a pollen patty in there when we set all this up and we're putting in that queen cage, I would say no, it's not necessary based on what the other bees are doing. There's a lot out there. And yes, you should see an increase in activity within the next week. More foragers, more resources coming in, because that would indicate, as I said early on in today's discussion, if there's 10 or more pollen-bearing bees going in there, then you can pretty well bet that she's in lay and that they are dealing with hatched out larvae, which hatch after the third day. That's when they're going to start feeding. That's when they're going to need bee bread. So, and bee bread, how long does it take them to work that up? So once they bring the pollen in, they put it in and they mix it with their mandibular gland material, and they actually add a little sugar to that, and they cap it with a little bit of honey or nectar. Then it starts to ferment. They like to use that about 48 hours out of its initial install. So it doesn't benefit the bees to do that way ahead. See, so that fresher stuff is what they go for first. So 48-hour bee bread is what the bees show a preference for. And that's through observation, looking at my observation hive and watching the bees pack those cells full of pollen and then drawing grease pencils on there and seeing when they did that. And then I get to see when they start to deplete it, when they start using it and feeding that, using that to feed those developing larvae. So it's very interesting. We hope to see a change next week as the queen and colony settle in the roles. Then the colony existing brood emerges. So please keep us posted about that, because it's going to be interesting to know. But I see the pollen patty as, you know, that's an insurance policy that they may not touch at all, but don't be alarmed about that. Landing board activity is going to tell you the whole story if they're bringing in that. And then, of course, 10 days out, you can do an inspection. Limit the inspection time. So in other words, when you get in there mid-afternoon, look in, and as soon as you find young brood, open brood, or you find eggs, if you see any eggs, button it up and get out of there. That's it. You got your answer. So the less interruption, the less intrusion, the better they're going to do. Moving on to the next question. Josh, just curious, if you get a new colony in the early spring in northern Minnesota, or MN, I don't know if that's Minnesota or Maine. So anyway, could you use the pollen patties to help jumpstart the colony to help create comb and ready to go when the pollen starts flowing within 2 or 3 weeks? Okay, so you're getting a new colony in early spring in northern, I'm going to say northern Maine. So anyway, if you're getting that, usually you're getting your packages or you're getting nukes and things like that in sync with a nectar flow, a spring nectar flow. So if you're ahead of that, it's kind of odd, because most people also that are selling packages, that are selling nucleus colonies and things like that within an area, do so also when the pollen and nectar flow starts, because that's when their populations of their bee colonies starts to explode. But you have nothing to lose other than your money, because I want to tell you, now I just keep holding this up because I happen to have these around right now, but this is 15% protein in the form of bee pollen, real bee pollen. So if I were to put this on a hive and the environment has not yet started to yield pollen resources, this would benefit the bees, and they would definitely go after it because there's a bunch of sugar. Sugar is the number one ingredient. Soy, yeast, water, 15% pollen. So there are other things in here that the bees would consume. And if not, when the pollen starts meaningfully coming in through the entrance, then that's when you would be able to pull this out when you do your inspection. So that is just about it. So when the pollen flow Yes, that first week or two, it's a benefit to get them going. So sure, try it. It sounds like you may already have it ready to go anyway, so why not just do that? So that's it for today. Those are the questions. The rest is fluff. So now we're just talking. Now we're just sitting around. Oh wait, let me get some hot chocolate. What should we talk about? A lot of people were talking to me about this new feeder that came out. So I bought this myself. I bought it on Amazon. This is a small version of the wraparound feeder. How does it look size-wise? Wraparound feeder is a lot bigger. This little thing is about the same height, actually, too. So somebody said, "Hey, Fred, go get one of these. They fit inside the flow hive. And you can put the gabled roof on and everything else." Well, I know for sure it doesn't fit the Flow Hive 6-frame Flow Super because I tested that just before I did this video and I put it on the inner cover, put it in the hole, tried to put the gabled roof on. It sits right on this and does not completely enclose it. So it would fit in the 7-frame Flow Hive gabled roof and the 7-frame would not rest on this. The capacity of this is greatly reduced. There's some interesting parts to it. I like that it's clear, and that's why somebody brought it up to me because I mentioned before, oh man, it'd be cool if they made one of these where you had the clear top, so when you have dry sugar in it, you would be able to look just through the clear top without exposing them and without letting all the hot air out of that upper box. And then you could see right away if the bees are on it without opening it and looking in. So this satisfies that. And I did not, unfortunately, measure the capacity. The capacity is not written on here. And it has the little dishwasher safe emblem on this cover part. And there are little perforations in it, too. There are little holes in this clear inner cover. And at first glance, I looked at that and I thought, oh, I don't want those little holes in there leaking hot air out into the winter. But you know what? In the wintertime, you don't have this anyway. But you do have this cover. Because we have dry feed in here in the winter. We have this cover now, but guess what? There's little holes in that too. So we put that on there. So you got a couple of choices. I like to leave these in the feeder shim with it because that way it's there. I don't have to hunt around when I'm going to look for it. But then I thought, look at this. I can just turn it upside down, set it on here, and block those holes. Now, if that's in a feeder shim, that's fine. It'll fit. If this is in a flow hive, it will not fit. So you're going to have it like this, but I recommend in the wintertime just plugging up these little holes, put scotch tape over it or something like that, so we're not venting through the top. And we want that moisture to be retained in there because the moisture will drip down onto your dry sugar and turn it into a little sugar brick that your bees are going to use if and when they need it. It's emergency feed. So it's okay. Smaller version should work. Nice and sturdy, lots of nice deep ridges on the outside and the inside for the bees to climb on. And a little different from the wrap arounds that I've been using because these clear cups on this one go all the way to the bottom. So no bees are going to escape underneath of it. And I did check to see that there's plenty of space over the top of this and between the underside of this so the bees can actually climb over and get through. And the other thing is, it does extend out a little bit. So when you're setting it flush, this does stick out, and that is perfectly matched. That round hole is perfectly matched to your flow hive inner covers. So for those of you who also may be looking into flow hives, look down in the video description. If you're going to buy something from them, get $50 off by using the links that I provide down in the description of this video. If you're listening on podcast, you can go to the video on YouTube and look in the video description and get a hold of that link. And there are several different links based on what part of the world you're in. So that leads me to something else. People have been getting robbed blind looking at links at the beginning of videos, and even these advertisements show up even on some of my videos. And it will say something ridiculous like "Flow hives on sale now, 75% or 80% off." That's the most frequent one that I've seen. Now, and then there'll be a very legitimate looking video showing the Andersons, and they're talking about their invention and people actually activating the flow hive, and all the logos are there and everything's there. And then down in the corner is a little banner that you're supposed to click on and buy now kind of thing. I want to warn you that those are pirates, that they're having a hard time keeping them off of YouTube for some reason. And that the Flow company has been trying very hard to get those taken down, but it's like whack-a-mole, they pop up everywhere. So what I want you to notice is, if wherever you shop for Flow Hive equipment, if it doesn't have Flow in the web address, and if it isn't a direct market, in other words, if when you click on a link like that, it takes you to a store that has a whole bunch of different sellers and a whole bunch of different kinds of products, and these Flow Hives are just part of it, I would stay away from that completely, because 9 times out of 10, they're getting your credit card information, they're giving you nothing, and it is just a shell game for them to take your money. And that is terrible stuff. So please know, and please tell other people, if it doesn't have Flow in the website, because there are a bunch of them, if it doesn't have Flow in the website, chances are it's not legitimate. And watch out, nothing is on sale for 75 or 80% off that's legitimate. And I see the fake, people send me pictures of the Flow hives that they got, or they send me pictures of somebody was making horizontal hives and selling them, and they had one that's modified for Flow hives. And then they showed me the pictures of the Flow frames that are in there. Every one of the frames that was in that was a ripoff frame. It was a patent pirated, not legitimate Flow hive frame. Very easy to tell the difference for me, because I've seen every iteration that they've had. So be aware when people are trying to sell you something inexpensively, or if they claim it, you can always go to the Honeyflow website and you can look up and see where the legitimate sales are taking place. And if this place isn't on it, please don't give them your credit card information and don't shop with them. Super bad news. So the other thing I want to tell you, this is something, and I'm going to mention it probably at every video, and that's because spring comes and people get desperate for bees. They didn't order them and they can't get the bees they want. I noticed at Man Lake, for example, I get nothing by mentioning these people. I get no kickback. I get a discount if you buy something from the Flow Hive company, though. But if you go to Man Lake and you look at the bees, they are selling a wide range of Corniolans, Italians, the Saskatrass bees. So they're selling packages of everything right now. So the way Man Lake works is they're contracting with breeders, and it's actually shipping from the breeder, but Man Lake is handling the sales at retail level for them. So that's what you're doing. But right now, they have a whole bunch of different bee varieties. So if you want to do that, make sure you get your orders in early enough, because there's a very good chance that they will be sold out at the time that you decide. So the other thing is, make sure and have all your equipment ready to go. Pick the spot where you're going to have your beehives. Get your stands out there. Make sure it's nice and level or slightly tilted towards the landing board. And pick your hive stand design. A lot of people don't want to build their own hive stands, so there are a bunch of different designs out there. And don't forget to set it up so that your landing board is going to be, if you live where skunks are, you want that landing board to be at least 16 inches off the ground to prevent skunks from jumping up and eating your bees. The other thing is, for those of you who have bees, and we already mentioned it in here, please make sure you're ready for swarm season. It catches even the most experienced beekeepers off guard. Their hives build up faster than they thought. It's a meteoric rise, and they explode out of there, and now you've got a swarm that is huge. So 10 frame deep, ready to go to catch those swarms. If you're putting out swarm traps, put them out now. So that's the other thing. The lay-ins hive. There's some interesting things about the lay-ins hive that I bought from horizontalbeekeeping.com, which is Dr. Leo Sherishkin's website. Again, no affiliation with him. I get nothing for mentioning him. But I bought his best lay-ins hive, and I'm looking it over because I'm planning, because I got to put my bees in it in spring. Now, normally I would do a split. So I would just look at, and this is one way to, by the way, cut back on swarms. So you look at the hive in your apiary that's the most active, it's got the most bees, they're just going gangbusters. Great selection for a split. So what I would normally do would, you know, I'd pop the cover on that colony and look at how many frames of brood they have and everything else. And I would just pull those frames. And this year I'm going to stick them in a hive butler tote, because if it's a horizontal hive, you can't carry it around. Okay, so the horizontal hives are set up. My long lang, too heavy. That's a two-man carry easily if it's empty. So anyway, we're going to have to set up this Layens hive, which has deep frames. I can't just go into my most robust colony of bees, pull a bunch of frames, push the existing frames together now, and replace the outer frames with new frames, and then take my frames of brood, frames of, you know, open larvae and everything else to start my new colony. And if they've got queen cells just starting out, that's the perfect thing to be putting into my new colony, or I can actually take the existing queen with me. So either way, you reduce the numbers, the congestion in that colony, you take some of the resources, and what we've done is taking care of removing a lot of the triggers that would cause them to swarm. But I can't just put them in this Layens hive, because the Layens hive frames are dramatically different from Langstroth hives, so they're not compatible. So I have to be creative about what I'm going to put in there. So what I'm actually going to have to do with that one, this is my plan anyway. I'm going to keep an eye on my bees that are going to swarm. And then when they do swarm, I'm going to collect that spring swarm that's usually huge. It's like this. And that's going to be dumped into my Layens hive. But it is a compatibility issue that I noticed right away. I've had a bunch of them and I needed to populate them with splits. I have frame design issues, because they're not compatible with Langstroth equipment. So anyway, that's about it. If you're watching this and you want to get questions answered, you've got pictures you want to share, you've got little bits of video that you want to get opinions on and things like that, please join us on Facebook. It's the Way to Be Beekeeper Fellowship. And once you get in there, day and night, there are people in there talking about stuff, sharing their opinions, and that's it. We have moderators there that keep people from being bullies. It's not a big spam area where a bunch of people are just trying to shove marketed items at you. We don't allow that. And it's a place where you can get advice from other beekeepers all over the world anytime, day or night. So please check it out. Thank you for being here today. I hope you're warmer than I am. And I also hope you have a fantastic weekend. Thanks for watching.